excluding the gift shop, we don't get into all the different issues of, with separate reporting of the accounting for it. Basically, what would happen is the town would simply make a contribution of the gift shop's net proceeds to the project, the museum, each year.
So the town itself would be running the gift shop and using the space?
That's right.
Okay.
Other clarifications on this particular lease?
Basically, we're trying to keep the museum corporation just as simple as possible, and so that we can save on auditing and other expenses.
Could I have a motion, please? Counselor Coxell.
We've just had a little discussion down here as to whether or not it should read non-residential portion of the keeper's quarters building.
That makes it a little more explicit that the garage is not included.
Is that addition acceptable to all?
I move as amended.
Second.
Okay, we do have a an amended motion. Do we need a vote on that one? No, we can just take that as the original motion, can't we? Okay.
Well, how does the keeper's quarters, they don't have a building, what do they have?
That distinguishes it from garage building. Some people may envision that the garage is part of the keeper's quarters.
Okay, we have a motion and we have a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. Item 73 is to consider a report from the town manager regarding revised sewer rates that reflect the new monthly billing and the establishment of sewer past due interest and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
This does not change the rates at all. It's simply, you know, when we give out a copy of the sewer rates to folks, it would be nice to have what we give out to them correspond with the way the billing is being done by the district. So what we've done is taken the what has been the quarterly charge since June 1, 1991, and divide by three. The incremental charge remains the same. However, it begins after 300 feet instead of after 900 feet because you have to divide the usage as well by into the monthly periods. In addition to that, the district now does have the ability to charge interest on late sewer payments. What the practice has been is that we only have begun charging interest on December 15th and June 15th of each year. So for what you service that you used during December, January, February, March, April, May, as it now stands, you could go until June 15th without paying a nickel and without being assessed any penalty. What this would provide is that it coincide with the district that interest would start accruing after 25 days, which is what the statute allows for water bills. Although technically, because of debates and disputes, it probably won't be assessed for 28 days, but the notice will read 25. That's what the district does plan to do, and I think a good business practice would be for us to do the same in order to encourage timely payments of sewer bills. We used to have receivables of about $8,000 when they turned it over every 6 months. The last turnover, actually, the one in December, I know, was $24,000. So it shows that we ought to get serious about this and encourage people to make timely payments. I'm not sure what the turnover was in June. Do you remember, Deb?
26,000.
So I would encourage you to adopt that change.
Could I have a motion?
Move the adoption.
Second it.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
One question. I've been told since the water company went on monthly billing that their water bill has gone up. Is that a fact?
No, they had planned to go up, but because of the petition initiated by the Cape Elizabeth Council, the rates have not gone up.
Well, I didn't say the, you know, I didn't mean the rates had gone up, I meant they didn't take their water bill and, you know, and divide it out. They got an increase on their water, present water bill.
I believe they're doing estimates in some instances and not exact readings, which is the experience I've heard from a number of people, and the estimates tend to be, people are finding that the estimates, they feel, are higher than what the exact readings would be. It's not your old, your regular quarterly, your average quarterly rate divided by three very often.
Yeah, the bills also were very high during July because of the dryness, but I don't think we'll see that problem in August.
It might.
Although during hot weather, people take more showers and their bills do go up.
Oh, they do?
Or longer showers, they do.
Longer ones too?
Longer ones too.
Joan?
Move the question.
Yes, all those in favor? Thank you very much, a unanimous vote. Item number 74, to consider a report from the town manager regarding securing professional services to challenge the 30.9% rate increase request of the Portland Water District, which is now before the Maine Public Utilities Commission, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, this is a good, the wording of the agenda items this evening, I would like to thank Debbie Pizzo for putting together the agenda with the advice and consent of the council. I was away during the time it was done. And as an aside, since you did emphasize one of the words in the agenda item, a good opportunity to thank Deborah, if you allow me that diversion. Anyway, as you all know, there was a successful petition effort to require the PUC to look at the sewer rates that are proposed. I have met earlier with an attorney who's very well qualified. We had an additional meeting this morning with representatives of the towns of Falmouth, Scarborough, Cape Elizabeth, and Standish to meet with the attorney and go over the issue in Wyndham as well. The town manager Wyndham was there to go over in further detail. What we came up with, you know, was that, you know, to quote Henry Adams, it's not the time to be wimpish. If we're serious about fighting the water district on this particular issue and advocating single tariff rates, you're probably going to have to spend a little bit of money to do it. Already, because of the petition drive, Cape Elizabeth, under fire protection charges, has saved $4,234. The towns combined have saved over $14,000. Anyway, what we came up with was the feeling that including a rate engineer, perhaps an economist, and the attorney as well, it's going to take $50,000 to fight this thing. What was proposed is that this be raised from the individual communities based on what their current and proposed fire protection charges are, as well as what the consumption is within those communities. That we give double weight to the consumption as opposed to the fire protection charges. And what it means is, of the fund, Cape Elizabeth would pay 17.52% of the amount needed, Falmouth 16%, 16.77, Cumberland 7.2, Scarborough 28.09, Gorham 9.75, Wyndham an even 16%, and Standish 4.67%. Cape Elizabeth's share under this would be $8,760. It's interesting, one of the things the attorney said this morning, it wasn't in relation to how we're going to fund this, but he said he fully expects that the water district the PUC will waive the water rate increase for an additional 5-month period, taking advantage of the full 8 months that the statute allows. If that's the case, the amount that we will be saving because of the delay, it will be well over $10,000. The amount we're looking to fight this with, the request from Cape Elizabeth, is $8,760. So, you know, just because of the efforts now, we ought to be able to pay for this investment. Furthermore, you know, there's the potential here to save hundreds of thousands of dollars in the years ahead. Just, you know, if we won the issue on our fire protection charge alone, we would save almost exactly $100,000 a year based on what the current rate is as a municipality. Obviously, the revenue would come from elsewhere. Portland's fire protection charge would go up 2%, while ours would go down slightly. I think it's a good investment. Falmouth Town Council has already appropriated $10,000. The Cumberland Council is discussing it this evening. The Standish Council, they're being asked for $2,300, is discussing it tomorrow night. The Gorham Council has discussed it and as yet has not come up with any money. However, at this point, you know, they really didn't have a proposal before them based on equity and fairness, which this one, the people at the meeting thought it was. Scarborough has agreed that they will intervene and they wanted more information on the fire protection charges and other issues. And today at the meeting, I handed everyone the full, about 3-inch thick documentation so that those other communities are starting to do it. So, you know, I would strongly recommend that you appropriate $8,760 out of the overlay account. I know it's a tough year, money's tight, I know there are lots of other needs, but the water district situation is only going to get worse if we don't put our best foot forward at this point. Thank you.
Councilor Amaral.
Two questions. First of all, why wouldn't you recommend that we take the money out of the hydrant rental account, seeing that's where the savings is going to be experienced?
Because when we put the budget together, the water district didn't tell us that we were going to have the rate increase to the extent that we did, so it's really not available there. In spite of what we're saving is money that we would have been charged that we hadn't budgeted anyway.
The second question is, how are the cities of Portland and South Portland reacting to this effort?
Today was the deadline for intervener status. As of this morning, no one had filed as an intervener. South Portland, I've had several conversations with their finance director. They also, in Jerry Bryant's memo, the city manager's memo to the council, his weekly news of note or whatever he calls it, he did indicate that it was an issue they were going to follow. City of Portland attended the public hearing. They feel that, you know, that it ought to stay what it is, although Chief Winslow, Buddy Copeland Winslow, the fire chief, brought out the point very strongly that if we're going to be purifying water, why should that be charged on the fire protection charges, since the fire protection, you don't need water that's pristine. So, you know, Portland does have an interest in this as well. And, you know, Westbrook, very busy with the reval at this point, so I don't think they really get their teeth into it. But, you know, I would expect that they would defend their position. You know, looking at the numbers, you know, the water district sent one response to the PUC saying how terrible it would be, the city rates would go up and how stressful it would be. Yet the city rate going up per cubic foot charge is actually less than what the water district's already asking us for, even if it was equalized with a single tariff rate. So to me, that argument doesn't go anywhere, you know, of hardship, because they're already asking us for more. But it's not a sure thing. But you know, we've gone this far.
Mr. Jordan.
Yes, sir. You figured this on that 30.9% increase? Yeah. That's the way you made your figures?
You mean as far as the savings on hydrant rental?
Yes.
What?
Yeah.
That was based on what the rate actually would have been under their proposal if the petition had not gone in. Just in the first 3 months, we have saved $4,234.
So we're going in here with the idea that we're going to save that 30.9 and not a portion of it. Is that correct? That's our thinking.
That's the thinking. We have also delayed the water district from borrowing $10 million, which they had planned to do, I think, this month. But they have put that off. So we're also, you know, you can say, well, eventually it's going to catch up with you. But it isn't if they don't borrow that, because they haven't borrowed that money. We're not having to pay those interest expenses as part of the water rates. That isn't in there yet. So, you know, no matter what, there's a savings. Where there is a cost is in this whole thing is that the water district is going to be defending this. And the cost for that are going to be in their next rate increase. That's inevitable. You know, there's nothing to hold them back. And we had some other discussions at the meeting today about that that I don't want to state publicly.
No, I'm 100% in favor of this, and I think we should go after it, because I don't think it's fair the way they've done it for years. But my only point is, and what bothers me here tonight, is we start out with an attorney, then we get an economist, now we get an engineer. What do we have next? I mean, the professionals are the one that's going to make out on this deal.
They always do, Billy.
They always do, but I just had to point that out, so they know that I'm thinking in that direction.
There's a lot of professionals who live in Cape Elizabeth who benefit from...
And they're going to benefit from this decrease if we succeed also.
Yes, they will.
Yeah.
Unless they
so
work.
I hope they work hard.
And the farmers may benefit as well.
They might benefit a little bit, I guess, but not too much. We don't use any of the big meters, just small ones.
Billy, these other individuals will also underscore our not being wimpish on this issue.
Well,
going full.
I won't go to. I won't go any further with that one.
Councilor Amaral.
If the estimated cost, Michael, for the professional fees is expected to be in the area of $50,000, if the other communities decide not to come up with their share, where do we stand? I mean, I'd like to have somewhere in the motion that we will contribute up to $8,000 or whatever it is you're requesting, and that if some other community doesn't pick up their share, that we're not, you don't come back to us
right.
requesting.
Yeah. Falmouth was contingent upon two other communities going in. That was what the Falmouth Council approved, up to $10,000. You know, the discussion was if communities don't come in, the budget is reduced accordingly.
Okay. Oh. The budget goes down. They don't come back to us for more money.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
The budget is reduced accordingly.
I'm glad to hear that, because I'm very concerned, especially about Scarborough and Wyndham. They have, the Scarborough amount is over $14,000. The Wyndham amount is $8,000. And I have not felt strong support for this in those communities so far. You perhaps have picked something up in your conversations with the managers, but I can see us with a shortfall, especially out of those two specific communities. And I think the Falmouth idea of having our contribution contingent on two other communities makes some good sense. You know, and I applaud Falmouth for taking the lead in setting that.
Other points?
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to make another comment. I can't understand why Wyndham isn't in this kind of hole with borrowing Sebago Lake and where the water's coming from. I just can't understand it, and being one of the top ratepayers.
My sense at the meeting today was that Wyndham wasn't a whole lot caught up on the issues. And you know, in fact, none of the managers, other than myself, had even read the rate study up to now. And now they were going mainly on the summaries of it in the discussions. So you know, I think when they read that, and they were looking at it some today and getting angry when they were looking at how much Windows, or I think it was Standish, was getting charged like $700 per hydrant, while Portland was paying $100 per hydrant. And as they began to look through and see those things, the fur was beginning to fly. Standish is also very concerned that they're going to have this $43 million plan on their land or whatever it is, and yet they're having to pay double the fee that Portland pays. You know, meanwhile, you know, they get no tax benefit at all from it. So they're a little angry.
Good. Glad to hear it.
I guess, Mr. McGovern, I need a little clarification. Let's just say that the POC does postpone it an additional 5 months, so we have the thing in limbo for 8 months. At the end of that 8-month period of time, what are the possibilities of outcome? I mean, is one possibility that the Water District would perhaps settle out of court or back down and say, okay, well, we won't go 30.9%, but we'll go 20.9. I mean, are there varying degrees of increase that could still be exacted upon the town?
Once you turn anything over to another level of government, they have the right to do whatever they want to do with it. And the PUC, you know, could quadruple the town rates. You know, that's a chance you take. We don't feel that they will. And in fact, I don't know if you've read the response to the complaint that we filed earlier, they do seem to have a warm tone to the issues that we're raising. They're not rejecting them categorically.
But at the same time, is it overly optimistic to think that, you know, total victory would be 0% rate increase?
No. You know, the real issues we're fighting are two: how they determine fire protection charges, and whether or not we ought to have a single district mm-hmm. with one rate structure. Mm-hmm. And those are the issues we're looking at. We, to this point, have not directly attacked the issue of the overall revenue requirement.
The petition addressed that, didn't it?
The petition mentioned it in the intervener petition. Mm-hmm. is going to have just about five words that leaves open that possibility.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I want people who signed the petition to.
Yeah. And it's of definite interest, I know, to the town of Cumberland. And that's another reason why it was agreed to add that language.
However, if we're not going to we do not have unlimited funds for professional help, and we ought to zero in on the issues that we think are most important and not get caught up in the overall rate case that could cost a huge fortune.
The other thing that we're trying to do in this is if the PUC staff appears to be taking our position, we'll find that out a couple months down the road, we can end up having them do most of the work for us. You know, similar to this issue that I discussed at the beginning of the meeting, where there's another community who they're letting the Attorney General do their dirty work. You know, this is the exact same situation. We'll let the PUC do our dirty work if they're willing to do it.
How about our hard work?
And I don't mean that in any negative way, but I think it gets the message across. If we can utilize free services, we will.
May I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we authorize the town manager to secure professional services to challenge the 30.9% rate increase request of the Portland Water District in an amount of up to $8,760 for Cape Share, contingent upon two additional communities joining in the effort.
With the amount shown?
With the amount shown as expected from those communities.
Right.
Second motion.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. That's a unanimous vote. Item number 75 is to consider a report from the town manager regarding the allocation of local funds to provide for Route 77 traffic signals at its intersections with Spurwink Avenue and Shore Road and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Yeah, this is an issue which is, I know, of quite a bit of public concern. The MDOT doesn't plan to advertise this until November of 1992. However, you know, it seems to me that the public may not want to wait until then to express their views. So, you know, what I would suggest is that you have a public hearing on October 16th. And, you know, what will be before you after the public hearing is deciding whether or not to provide the local match for one of the lights or both of the lights. The local match for the Spurwink Avenue signal is $5,000. Out of a total project cost of $25,000. At the Shore Road, Scott Dye, Route 77 intersection, it's a $6,000 match out of $30,000 total project.
Some discussion on this item. Counselor Amaral.
What's the purpose of bringing this up at this time? If there's no intention to even allocate the funds statewide until, from the state until 1992 or 3?
I would have waited longer, except one of the town council goals for the year, one of the, I think the top 10 goals, it was pretty high, was to resolve the issue during this council year.
Wasn't your goal, was it?
Was not even on my list.
It wasn't, the council goal wasn't to say, look, we can help with the lights, and the council goal was, let's get the issue resolved.
I think it'll be difficult to get the public interested in if something, it's not going to happen for a couple of years. I don't see any sense in having a public hearing at this point on that issue.
The one thing I might add is that, you know, I don't think the council will say no to this. But if by chance you did, that gives us time to perhaps look around to see if maybe funds could be utilized for something else. I don't think they could be, but that gives us a lot more time for maneuvering than waiting until the very end of the period.
Can I ask for a clarification? Given that the Maine Department of Transportation has funded the projects, if the eventual decision is to not accept the money, the money is basically gone.
The money remains in the PACS area for reallocation by the PACS Policy Committee. Generally, it goes to the next project or projects on the list that were not funded. Those projects are not within Cape Elizabeth.
So we lose the money?
You lose the money.
Further discussion? Counselor Cogsell.
When was the last time the town received money from PACS? I mean, is it...
We received for the Route 77 improvement up here on the Strip.
Just this past year?
Yeah.
And before that, it was...
Before that, it was 1982.
82, okay.
And that was for the work done on Route 77 from Bothell's Garage to just into Southport, the bikeway there, and the reconstruction of the road, the bringing down of the hill there at the city town line.
Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I've had a couple of calls saying that we don't need a light at Spunk Avenue Ices. Well, you might by 1993. And they said, no, it's town managers is looking for a street light in Cape Elizabeth, was one comment. And here, guess where it come from?
You don't have to tell me.
I told him. He says, you ain't got guts enough to say it. I said, I'll say it publicly. But I do think that maybe we should proceed, but I agree, this is kind of a public hearing. And maybe just more of a hearing to get the feel of the people, but I think you take another year or two from now and what have you, that some people might be thinking different as far as the traffic in those two areas. I'm more concerned in the corner out here than I am Spunk Avenue. And you take early in the morning or 5 or 6 o'clock at night, you can wait quite a few minutes there at Scott Dial. I like to have my turn.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A question to Mr. McGovern. When do we have to have the town decision on this made?
They would make us an offer asking us to sign an interlocal agreement probably in the spring of 1993.
Well, 93.
93. It's not, that sounds like a long ways off, but it's only 15 months.
A year and a half.
It's amazing the way time flies.
When you're having fun talking to traffic signals.
I was just trying to be responsive to the council. You said you wanted it resolved.
Okay, that was one of my, council goals, because I thought it was a much tighter time frame. Go ahead.
Councilor Ambrose.
I would suggest another way to respond to council goals, if in fact it is a high priority. Request that the courier write an article and maybe interview some people in town or whatever, or present the issues and at least alert people to the fact that it's something that's coming down the road to be considered. But, and that'll pave the way for a public hearing maybe in another year.
So am I hearing that for the moment there may be some desire on the part of the council to indefinitely table this issue, or do we want to just vote down a public hearing? I mean, there are two ways to handle it.
Mr. Chairman, would we need another public hearing if we had this one? Would we need another one at a later date? Would we commit
to allocate those funds, but you know, that would be a judgment of the council at that point, whether or not you wanted to have another one.
When are we going to commit to PACs that we want the lights?
Well, they've had a problem, particularly with one other community, at reneging on projects. So what they'd like to do, we had a discussion as a PACs policy committee on setting a firm deadline, and it ended up that the proposed solution was worse than the problem, like so often happens. So we killed that indefinitely and said that instead we would merely have a system that every 3 months or so, each town would report in at where their project stood on the local approval process. And so, you know, I would just merely report if you put this off for a while that's what happened.
So if we had a public hearing, then the council, shortly after that public hearing, is going to have an item on the agenda saying we're going through or not.
Yeah. Well, I just think if you invite, my personal viewpoint, this is, when you invite the council, you invite the public to a meeting, that kind of expects some reaction from the council in the form of a decision. Otherwise,
no sense to have a hearing.
Yeah,
that's right. So we're committing ourselves.
You're voting at that time. If you vote yes, if you voted yes for both of them, it the issue would not come back before the council, with the one exception of approving the interlocal agreement. That would still need to be done, because that needs to be approved by the municipal offices. Although a lot of other towns don't take that position. They let, you know, Portland for one, the staff just does it once the council approves the funding for it. I lost my train of thought, but if you said no, you know, I'd still might bring it back in another year or so. Okay. After a year had expired.
I count Ambrose's idea of giving the public plenty of notice and information from both sides on the issue before we just automatically have a public hearing. I think we should allow them more time to think about it and know that it's coming.
Mm-hmm. Again, Councilor Pearson, we haven't heard yet.
Thank you, Chairman Cramlin. Agree somewhat with Councilor Amro, and I'd like to add to that that perhaps it would behoove us to wait to hear from the Town Center Planning Committee on their feelings towards the one, possibly two traffic lights proposed for Cape Elizabeth. Just to tie that in, maybe with publicity, it would also enhance an article in the Courier that could be all-inclusive, and they have their first report due, I believe, on the November
1st
meeting. And I think that at least if we can wait till then perhaps December or January might be better timing for the public hearing, just as a thought to be thrown about.
Mr. Manager.
Just one point on that. You know, that would be expanding the scope of the committee if you told them to do something outside the town center. But beyond that, you know, in order to, my concern with just dealing with the committee is that how would you be involving the public into that process, but just letting them know what's already been promised by the planning board over the last few years in looking at all the traffic studies for the congregate care facility and the nursing home, is going to be like over an hour and a half. You know, it'd be quite an undertaking for them. It's not, you know, what's their gut reaction. We'd want to provide some information and input to them.
Well, I think we should have a public hearing, but it's immaterial whether we have it in October or December, so that's where I look at it.
Councilor Amaral.
I think the closer it is to planning for the next fiscal year budget, the more sense it makes, because it's a budgetary decision. It should be included in the whole discussion of next year's budget. It's a piece of that. And I think that Kyle's idea of having some input from the town center committee for that traffic light that would go in the town center makes a lot of sense.
Perhaps someone might be ready to make a motion on this issue.
I would move that we table this indefinitely.
Second. There's a motion, there's a second. Is there further discussion?
No,
doesn't that kill it?
Is
that
totally? No, it can be. Well,
you can, usually that kills.
There's no discussion when you move to table it.
That's right.
Yes, but can it be brought up again?
Of course.
Yes, I mean, my understanding is that the issue can be brought back up at any time.
If you table indefinitely?
Right?
Yes.
I would defer to the clerk.
Cannot.
What's the time frequency that we can bring it up again?
Next year.
If ever.
Yeah. Next year.
Indefinitely means you can take it off the table whenever you want to take it off the table.
You can't. Not definite.
We just have to vote to.
You bring it up as a new issue.
Right.
Okay.
So we won't be taking it off the table, it'll just be an entirely new issue.
Right.
Okay. Is everyone clear about the motion? We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay, there's a unanimous vote. Thank you. Item number 76 is to consider the mail ballot for the election of the 1991-1992 Maine Municipal Association Executive Committee and Advisory Committee members, and to designate Cape Elizabeth's voting representative for the Maine Municipal Association's annual meeting and take any necessary action. I will defer to our town clerk, Ms. Pizzo.
You folks should have a copy of the mail ballot in your packet that is ready for your signature. Also, I would recommend that you consider designating Councilor Pearson as a voting delegate and the town manager as the alternate for MMA's annual business meeting October 24th in Bangor.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Amen.
Thank you very much.
I wondered why I got the Tootsie Rolls to start with.
Our last scheduled item this evening, item number 77, is to consider the acceptance of various gifts and take any necessary action. Again, I will defer to our town clerk, Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. We have provided you with a list of library gifts over the past year or so. These are basically gifts that have been provided to the library in memory of individuals. I'm also happy to provide you with a final list of the contributors to the Board of Veterans Recognition Committee fundraiser.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, I move acceptance of the gift as presented.
Second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second, all those in favor?
Aye, aye.
Thank you very much. Unanimous, 7-0. Again, thanks to all of the citizens who gave to the Thomas Memorial Library, as well as the War Veterans Recognition Committee. Is it my understanding that the committee is having its meeting this evening?
They ended earlier than the council.
They did. Well, again, our thanks and appreciation go to the committee for their excellent work. At this time on the agenda, I will invite citizens to discuss any particular items that are not on the agenda. Seeing no one here, we will conclude that area. I would move for adjournment. And a second, all those in favor? Thank you very much. Town Council thanks all of the viewers this evening. Good night.
that